Hello, Friendship West. How are you today? I hope that your day is going well. My name is Catherine Robinson, and I am part of the Gap Ministry. And we are here today to pray restoration. I know plenty of you, including myself, need to be restored. So why don't you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, how we thank you so much, oh God, for your mercy and for your grace, oh God. God, we honor you just because of who you are, Father. But on today, oh God, we're asking you, Father, to be restored. So many of us, oh God, are grieving in so many different ways, oh God. We're grieving the loss of loved ones. Where it just seems like we continue to lose family members back to back to back. We're grieving the loss of income, finances, the loss of relationships, brokenness, oh God. Generational curses, oh God, just grief to the point we toss and turn in the middle of the night just wondering if you're there, oh God. Then there are times, oh God, where we're hopeless and we're faithless. But we're asking you, Father, to restore us, to restore our minds, restore our hearts, renew our souls, oh God. We just want to get back to you, Father. Trials and tribulations that you said would come, but you also said that you would never leave or forsake us. You also said that you would carry us through the wilderness. And it's the truth because we're still here. We're still breathing. We're still existing, oh God, because of you, Father. So we want to get back to you. We want to get back to our prayer life. We want to get back to our one-on-one time with you. God, restore our peace. Restore our joy. Restore our love. Restore our passion, oh God. That the enemy tried to take away, Father. But God, when we get close to you, oh God, there's an overwhelming presence, which is your presence that falls upon us, oh God. And we experience your joy and your peace comes back, oh God. So we thank you. We honor you. We love you. We thank you for being restored in advance. In your Son Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, did you know Faith Formula Human Services has an emergency financial assistance program? That's right. We assist with utilities, rent, and even limited mortgage. In the month of March, over 4,000 families were evicted. 4,000 families became homeless in the month of March. Our partnership with the Redbird Outreach Collaborative, or ROC, allows us to be able to utilize funds from the ESG CARES Act to provide rental assistance to keep families in their homes. Additionally, we have funding for those who are unable to cover lights, gas, and even water bills. For both of these programs, applicants must reside in the city of Dallas. And if you do not live within the Dallas city limits, we have a list of partners on our website that may be able to assist in other areas. To apply, please visit www.faithformula.org.
Hello, Friendship West. I'm Deborah Pete Haynes, and I want you to know that God has resources for even extreme times such as this. This book, Ready and Able, exposed to me by Dr. Jewel Pookrum, written by Dr. Jewel Pookrum and her colleague, actually will tell us what to do in so many extreme circumstances. For instance, do you have a generator? What type of food should you eat in an emergency? What type of foods can help build your immune system? And so much more. So please go to friendshipwest.org and search for our store and download this book today. It will be so helpful. Proceeds will go to Friendship West, and we want you to know that we're always here looking for ways to give you information so that you can be safe, you can be successful, and you can have faith and hope even in extreme times as this. Please download Ready and Able on friendshipwest.org in our store. Thank you so much.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, Friendship West. Good morning to our first-time visitors. Good morning to those of you who are visiting us online this morning. Come on and stand on your feet. Let's give God the glory, the honor, what he deserves, because he has brought us through a long week. Y'all already know it. Are you ready to be revived? Are you ready to be renewed? Are you ready to be made whole? Well, God has already done it, so let's step into it, and let's go ahead and go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, how we thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for your glory, for your mercy, for your honor, oh God. God, we thank you, Lord, for your compassion, for your love and grace. Oh God, we just thank you for how you have kept us, oh God. God, we can talk about all of the things that we're going through. We can talk about all of the financial issues and the heartbreaks and relationships and what's going on at work and road rage, oh God. But we serve a God who is able, who is in control over all things, oh God. Thank you, oh God, because we're going to praise you in advance for our deliverance. We're going to praise you in advance for our breakthrough, oh God. Thank you, God. We ask that you massage our hearts on this morning with your amazing word that you have already poured into Bishop this morning, oh God. God, we don't want to leave here the same, oh God. So we thank you for what you've already done, oh God. We thank you for our amazing praise team, the amazing choir, the band, the word, the praise dancer. Thank you for Dr. Pastor Haynes, oh God. We just thank you, oh God, on this morning. So our hearts is open to you. Remove any distractions. Remove any negative thoughts. Remove any lies. Remove Satan, because this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. God, we love you. We honor you. We bless you in your holy son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessing me. Oh, my God. be glad. And it, does anybody know that you have a God who's in the business of blessing you, of keeping you, not just one time, but over and over and over and over and over and over? Okay, that didn't get you. Have any of you all been forgiven over and over and over and over? Have any of you seen God open up a door you didn't even knock on? Not just one time, but over and over and over. Have any of you seen God come through while you were going through? And God didn't just do it one time, but God did it over and over and over. So why don't you make a joyful noise to the God who's in the over and over and over and over business? God ain't done. God ain't dead. God is gonna do it over and over and over. Come on, make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Come on, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Come on, give God praise, because God is good. God is good. God is good. Since God is good over and over, I'm going to just say it over and over. God is good. God is good. God is good. God is good. Over and over. You may be seated if you can in the presence of our great God. Listen, it's Christmas in July. Christmas in July. Transforming Life Revival is here. And of course, Bishop Rudy McKissick. Bishop Rudy McKissick. Man, I was talking to Abani a few days ago, and she was asking me how this whole thing got started. It got started on Keast on a Saturday night. Bishop McKissick was in town, I guess with Kim, for Mary Kay. That's right, for Mary Kay. And I found out he's in town. I said, man, well, come preach for our Saturday night live service. His very first time. And you know what he did. And so after service, I got bombarded. It was really a trip. Usually our guests have all the people in the line speaking to them. Y'all came talking to me about him. Pastor, we can't just have him for one service. We got to have him for a whole week. We need to have him for Transforming Life Revival. And for over 20 years, it's been happening, because we've been here 16 years and we started on Keast. And so God has just done something phenomenal. And here's what's so amazing. Bishop McKissick, every year, is fresh. It's like, as amazing as he was the year before, it's like the next year, the old folks saying, every round goes higher and higher. And so I ain't got to introduce him. All I got to say is Bishop Rudolph McKissick, who is the pastor of the Great Bethel Church there in Jacksonville, Florida. But this week, he's Bishop of Friendship West Baptist Church, because we know he's got it like that. So would y'all welcome home Bishop Rudolph McKissick Jr. Welcome him back to Friendship West. Welcome him home. He ain't seen y'all in 3 years. Y'all ain't seen him in person in 3 years. So come on, let's welcome him home and let's get ready to see what God is going to do this week. Uh-oh, here come the praise dancers.
I
This is the day that the Lord has made. Anybody want to rejoice and be glad in God on today? Come on, if you're excited to be in the house of the Lord, if you're glad God has given you another opportunity, even at home, I want you to stand up. Put your eggs down for a minute. Stand up and everybody give God a great praise. Come on, if you know God is worthy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God, we thank you. We thank you for the total sufficiency of your Son and our Savior. We thank you that you have gathered us in this sacred space to hear from your word, to worship your name. And God, it is my prayer that the power that is on the scene be felt even through the screen. We've come to be transformed and we've come to be revived. And so as we begin this journey today, bless us all week, oh God. Stand up not only in me, but in all the proclaimers that are to join and partner with us this week. God, we believe miracles are going to happen this week. We believe expectation is going to be revived this week. We believe conviction and challenges and confirmations are going to come through your word. So we ready ourselves to hear what the Spirit has to say to the church. Now use me for your own good pleasure. Stand up in me as I move out of your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, listen, before y'all sit down and even at home, I need y'all to holler as loud as you can for the baddest one in the land, your pastor. Can y'all help me thank God for my big brother, the Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass? Hey, y'all can do better than that. I need y'all to holler at your boy like you just, yeah. Take your seats in the presence of the Lord. Now listen, last year I preached and wasn't nobody in the pew. So I'm just glad to see Lottie Dottie and everybody who's in the pew, because last year he made me preach to an empty, I felt like I was David in the cave of Adullam, like wasn't nobody in here. And we came in here and had a good time, but it's good to see y'all. Yeah, it is. As Pastor Haynes said, this has been going on for a minute. I wasn't gray when I first started, because that's how you know it's been a long time. I'm gray. All my children are grown. And yeah, so it's been a while. We've been coming here to the Friendship West. I'm like the Winans. Millions didn't make it, but I'm one of the ones who did. So I'm just glad and thank God. I thank God for my big sister, your first lady, just walking in, and I'm so honored and blessed to see her this morning. Y'all ready for a good week? I think it's gonna be a good week. I'm so excited even about Pastor Jackie tomorrow and Pastor Reggie on Tuesday, and then my boy Marcus D. Cosby on Wednesday. It's just gonna be an amazing week. So hey, let's get this party started right. If you've got your, we used to say you got your Bible. Now if you've got your Bible app, that's what I tell folk on Sunday. Now take your Bible app, or if you're old fashioned, you got your paper Bible. Go to the Gospel of John. To everybody watching us at home on the streaming platforms, we welcome and thank God for you. Gospel of John chapter 4. And you can stand with me as is your custom. Now I'm just gonna warn you, you're gonna stand for a minute, you. So just know, I ain't seen y'all in 3 years. So whatever I do this week, y'all gonna be like, well, we haven't seen him in 3 years, so he can do whatever he wants to do. Gospel, somebody said amen over here. The Gospel of John chapter 4. I'm going to begin reading at verse 4. This is the word of the Lord. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman.
How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Sir, the woman said, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock? Jesus answered, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst again. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water so I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. He told her, go call your husband and come back. Jesus just being messy. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you've had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. That could be read a whole lot of ways. What you have just said is quite true. Sir, the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and God's worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know that the Messiah called Christ is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus declared, The one speaking to you, I am he. Just then his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want, or why are you talking with her? Here's the verse. Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah? Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our God. Leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town. Leaving her water jar, leaving her water jar, leaving her water jar. I want to preach this morning as we begin this transforming life revival with this thought in our minds. I didn't lose it, I left it. I didn't lose it. I left it. If there is one thing that we as humans are not built for, it is leaving. The problem with leaving is something that is built into us right from our very time in the womb. If you think about it, a baby is comfortable inside the womb of the mother. It's warm, though dark it may be. It's insulated. And as a matter of fact, the only reason a baby leaves is because they have outgrown the space they have been confined in. No, they have been growing in, which really means a part of growth is outgrowing spaces. And in those spaces that you have outgrown, watch this, when your comfort is greater than your transition, God will find a way to break and push you out. We have a hard time. We have a hard time with leaving. In the psychology of leaving, many psychiatrists point out that there are two main things involved in leaving. Number one, you are dissatisfied with your current situation. And number two, no matter how dissatisfied you feel, we often don't leave because we feel anxious and uncertain about the alternative options. Psychologist Dr. Rob Archer says that the mind prefers the status quo. In other words, our minds prefer the things it already knows. And the wrestle becomes that although my mind prefers the status quo, I want more out of life than safe. Overwhelmingly, in a poll that was taken, it was discovered that people, more than anything, want the chance to author their own lives, make positive decisions and break free from the inertia of life. Yet it is impossible to do this without taking a risk, and minds prefer certainty. So people often end up staying where they are, watch this, more by default than choice. They console themselves with hopes that their situation will get better while settling for small compensations. So then God sometimes has to come along and make the decision for us and cause the water to break on our comfort and push us into where God wants us next. We find that truth at work once again in this familiar story. This woman can't leave the mental and emotional place she's in as a result of her life choices. She's having trouble leaving how she has developed who she sees herself as. But here's the shout this morning. The place she thought was an escape was really a setup. Because what you think you can't get past, Jesus shows up to help you get beyond. God, I came to talk to somebody. It says that Jesus must needs, that's the way that King James puts it, must needs go through Samaria, through a little place called Sychar. This is a place where Samaritans hang, and Jews and Samaritans have this long-standing, y'all know this, hatred of each other. Jews and Samaritans saw Samaritans as half-breeds. And Jesus stops at what was and is still known as Jacob's Well. He's tired, he's thirsty, he's hungry. And here comes this sister with a challenged resume. Now, what is odd about the encounter is the time in which it happens. I know where I am. Y'all already know this. Normally, women come to the well early in the morning to avoid the heat. She sure couldn't have come in Dallas. But this woman comes at noon, at the height of the heat of the day. And she comes, it is believed, to avoid being seen by the sisters. The noonday heat was dangerous. Watch this. Which means she would rather hurt herself than face herself. Because when you don't manage pain, you will manipulate your world in order to avoid feeling it. Preach Rudolph McKissick. Jesus starts up this conversation with her, which is strange because of who she is. A man was not supposed to speak to a woman in public unless they were related. And what goes on in this text is a surprise, rule-breaking savior introducing a sister to her unknown possibility because of what she would not leave. This conversation that Jesus has with this woman is a surprise. That Jesus would even talk to this woman is a surprise. That Jesus would even treat this woman with potential is a surprise. As a matter of fact, that's really his track record. All through the scripture, we can find persons that God did things that were surprising. Noah was surprised when God told him he would save his family and himself while destroying the earth with a flood, and all he had to do was build something he had never built before. Abram was surprised by God when God said he would be the father of a nation when he had no child. Moses was surprised by God when God wanted a meek, stuttering, homicidal maniac to lead Israel. Samuel was surprised by God when God told him to go down to the house of Jesse, and there he would find the new and the next king. Jesse was surprised by God when God revealed that the next king would not fit the description of their logic, but would be a snot-nosed young boy. Naaman was surprised by God when he was able to bathe in the dirty Jordan and come up clean from his leprosy. I said, God specializes in surprises by using the unexpected. As a matter of fact, God not only surprises in what God will do for you and through you, but God specializes in surprising others in what God does through you that they never saw you being able to do. You've got some people who are surprised at what God has done for you. I can prove it in the Bible. Joseph's brothers got surprised when the brother they sold into slavery from a pit showed up in the palace. Goliath and Saul got surprised when David took a stone and killed an oversized giant. Pharaoh got surprised when he and his army tried to pursue Moses and the children through the Red Sea and ended up drowning in what the children walked through. Nebuchadnezzar got surprised when, after he put three in a furnace to burn, they had enough faith to walk. Jezebel got surprised when God defeated her gods and her men through one prophet at the top of Mount Carmel. Darius got surprised after he put Daniel in the den of lions, only to discover the next day that Daniel prayed on his prey and came out all right. The disciples got surprised when on the sea in a storm, Jesus woke up and shut it down. The Jews got surprised after they put Jesus on a cross one Friday, that when they went by the tomb on Sunday, he was not there. White folk were surprised when we refused to be satisfied with crumbs, but wanted the whole loaf. The Republicans got surprised when a black woman handled them and her business to become the next Supreme Court justice. Trump was surprised when good triumphed over evil and got rid of him. Black men were surprised when women started preaching the gospel and went from the kitchen with oil to the pulpit with voices. Your haters were surprised when you survived their lies. Your co-workers were surprised when you got the job but they had the experience. Your doctor got surprised when they told you what couldn't be done, but God did it anyhow. The banker got surprised when they took down your info but warned you it couldn't happen. That teacher got surprised when they told you what you'd never be and you became everything they didn't think. You got surprised when you thought you were done and hopeless, but God made a way out of no way. And is there anybody in here that can look at your neighbor and yell behind that mask, "Surprise!" You to holler like you know God specializes in surprises. As a matter of fact, cameraman, you ought to pan the audience just in case your haters are watching, and just wave your hand and just say, "Surprise! How you like me now? You didn't think I would make it. You didn't think I would survive, but I have a God." Come on, look at somebody. "Surprise, I'm still here. Surprise, I'm still thriving. Surprise, I'm still married. Surprise, I'm still happy and single. Surprise, I'm still black but prosperous. Surprise."
No. Sit down. Sit down. God, don't y'all mess with me. God specializes in surprises. And I came to tell somebody today, in here or at home, God even specializes with unusual assignments. Oh, man. And sometimes before you can walk in the assignment, he's got to work on what you can't leave. Woo. Because what you won't leave is where you stop. Preach, boy. It's principle of life that whatever or whoever you can't leave determines where you will stop in one aspect of your life. Whatever you can't separate from mentally or even physically, or whoever you can't uncouple yourself with emotionally, whether it be a friend, an ex-spouse, an ex-boss, a co-worker, boo, bae, whoever it might be, what you won't leave is where your life will stop. Because here's the reality: you never find momentum backwards. The end of the story, this is probably the wrong way to do this homiletically, and I'm in here with the great homiletic superhero, Freddie Haynes, and you probably shouldn't do this, but the end of the story is what got me. She left her water pot. She went there with the water pot at noon to avoid women and to get water. She left the water pot, and we could surmise from the logic of the discourse that she never got the water. But even if she got the water and the writer didn't tell us, she left it where she was. Don't miss it. She forgot about everything she came there for. Jesus, God help me today. She put that water pot out, and I want to submit to you that this water pot is symbolic. It was as if she said, I won't be needing this anymore. God help me. The water pot was symbolic of her pain, symbolic of her misery, symbolic of her past, symbolic of people's perception of her, symbolic of her perception of herself. But once she met Jesus, she said, I will not need this anymore. She dropped it and she left it where she, I don't know who I'm talking to today, but God told me to tell you, you got some water pots. I see it on top of your head right now. You ain't smiled since you've been in here. You haven't clapped since you've been in here. You haven't lifted a hand since you've been in here. It's because you got to use your hand to hold that water pot to keep your pity party going. But I came to tell somebody, it's time for you to leave it. Now you need to be drawn by your future and not pushed by your past. Can I tell you that you know you've been delivered when you demonstrate what you're willing to drop and leave behind? She dropped it, and some of y'all need to drop it today. Some of y'all need to leave it today. Let me show you how Jesus gets you together so you can leave some stuff. Here's the first thing text teaches me. When the Lord's working on you to leave some stuff behind to push you into your future, I love this. God uses you when God doesn't need you. I know y'all ain't gonna say much, huh? God uses you when God doesn't even have to. I'ma reword it for some of y'all. God uses you when God doesn't even have to. Now I know that we get this theological principle from the Bible that God is looking to partner with people in the earth realm to bring about God's will. I done heard all of that. And I also know that God has chosen to do so when God does not have to. Okay, I can show it to you from the text. Jesus starts this conversation by asking her for a drink. Now I know he's showing us his humanity in being thirsty, but he asked her for a drink. Y'all ain't got it yet. Jesus stops at this well, and in his humanity, he's thirsty, and he waits till she gets there to ask for a drink. Y'all ain't got it yet. He is living water. God, I feel it. And yet he asks her for something to drink. Y'all ain't got it yet. He participated in making water. God, preach Rudolph McKissick. As a matter of fact, we know from the Bible, water listens to him. Y'all ain't with me yet. Y'all remember out there on that sea, don't you? When they came and said, Master, don't you care that we're perishing? And the Bible says he woke up and spoke to the water and told the water, peace. God, I feel like preaching. Be still. Which means we know that he has the ability to make water do whatever he wants water to do. And yet, knowing he could get the water for himself, he waits till she gets there. Woo! Because this ain't about water. This is about assignment. I'm trying to help somebody through here. Here's the blessing of being used by God. God could do it without you. But God honors you with the weight of your call. And instead of complaining about what you have to do, you should be thankful that God has chosen to use you when God don't really need you. I know y'all ain't gonna shout on this. Can I talk to you? You have no right to be assigned, anointed, and arrogant. Y'all don't want to talk to me. Y'all still got your pandemic posture on. You have no right, woo, to be anointed and arrogant when you know the only reason you're anointed is because God chose to anoint you when God did not have to anoint you. I mean, think about how flawed and jacked up your life has been. And yet God still sees value in you. It ought to make you be grateful that God sees something in you that God wants to use when God could do it without you. You are called for what you ain't even qualified for. I just said something should have made somebody run. You are called for what you're not even qualified for, because your calling doesn't say you are great, but your calling says God is good. I love it in here. He doesn't need you. Can I take it further? Y'all really not gonna like this. All the bad and bougie raindrop drop top folk, y'all might want to leave on this one. God uses you when God doesn't need you. But here's what's couched in the middle of that from this text. Jesus, y'all not gonna like this. Jesus uses her before he fixes her. Ain't nobody gonna get excited about that but me. He uses her before he fixes her. Y'all don't like that. See, because in the church, we want folk to get fixed before they can be used. Y'all ain't gonna talk to me. In the church, we want them to be off the weed, to stop shacking up, to get the, y'all, why y'all done got quiet? To stop cussing, to stop drinking douce. But this text teaches me that he can use you even before he fixes you. Do I have a witness in here today? God help me. I love it, because that means Jesus uses me knowing everything about me that I can shout, because that means I am not what I have done. And once you realize this, it'll change everything. Sit down. Sit down. It's just Sunday. Sit down. See, when you realize this, I'm trying not to get too excited. When I realize that as jacked up as I am, God can still use me. Now, you don't have to reduce yourself to be chosen. You don't have to lose yourself to be loved. Woo, y'all don't like it. You can stand up and say, the Lord chose me. I'm chosen. I don't even know why, but I'm just glad he chose me. You can come to church with Negroes giving you the side eye because they know everything about you and can't figure out how you got the leadership role, and you ain't got to answer them. All you got to do is keep on moving. Y'all ain't helping me, because God chose you. I'm not looking for everybody, but I'm looking for about 99 of y'all who can just say, God, I thank you that with my messed up, jacked up, unfixed up self, you still had me on your mind and you chose me for something. All right. Now, let me move to the second point the text teaches. Don't holler at me like that. It's been a long time. Don't do that. Don't do that. Let me tell you the second thing text teaches us. That the Lord doesn't want a used you without a changed you. See, because I don't want anybody to walk out of here talking about, I ain't got to get my life together. The Lord uses me before he fixes me. No, let me give you the balance. I don't want anybody walking out of here talking about, yeah, the bishop said, you know, I ain't got it all together yet. But no, let me give you the balance. He uses her before he fixes her, but refuses to leave her like he found her. I'm trying not to run myself. Let me say it one more time. He uses her before he fixes her, but he refuses to leave her like he found her. Y'all ain't saying that. See, you can't have a first-class destiny with an economy mindset. So now Jesus has to work on her so that change and transformation happens. Are y'all listening to me this morning? So they start this dialogue because he doesn't want her to walk away thinking she could be used by him and ain't got to change nothing. That's why I let y'all shout early. So watch how the dialogue goes. Jesus says, give me something to drink. They go back and forth. And Jesus, you know, says to her, I am he. I am living water. Watch what she says. She says, give me this water so that I'll never be thirsty again. She just added that because that wasn't what she really meant. The second thing she said is what she really wanted it for. And so I ain't got to keep coming back here. Because coming back here keeps reminding me of what I've done. Y'all ain't trying to help me. And if I can avoid coming here, I can escape being confronted. And if I can escape being confronted, I can continue being comfortable in the stuff I do. That's why some of us don't like to go to a church where we get challenged to grow and stretch. You'd rather go to a clickbait church where a preacher is giving you clickbait sermons full of phrases and pep rallies so that you can stand up and wave and high-five your neighbor about your haters and what God's going to do for you. But every now and then, if you really going to grow, you got to be confronted with you. That's all right, y'all give me them cute claps. That's all right. I've been coming here 20-some years. I don't really care. He wants to deal with you. So she said, give me that because I won't keep coming here. So Jesus said, go get your husband. Now, let me help y'all because in a few minutes he says, you're right. That ain't your husband. Matter of fact, not only that, you done had five and the one you got now ain't your husband. That could be taken a whole lot of ways. But what I love is Jesus knows all she's doing, and he doesn't judge her, but works on her. See, and contrary to the misogynistic theology I hear preached from this text, she ain't got a man problem. She ain't got a sex problem. Come on, don't get quiet. In spite of all the misogynistic theology out here, she ain't got a man problem. She ain't got a sex problem. She doesn't have a sexual addiction. She ain't got a flesh problem. She's got a broken problem. And brokenness manifests itself in various ways. This ain't about her being loose, a hoe. That's that misogynistic stuff. It ain't got nothing to do with that. Nothing to do with that. She's broken. And she needs her brokenness fixed. Y'all done got quiet. Here's the problem, because she's broken. Don't worry, we're going to shout in about 10 minutes. She's been trading, Freddie, her authenticity for attachments. Because she thought her authenticity was in attachments. Woo! So who I'm connected to makes me somebody. Okay. And that's what many of us do. We compromise our character just to be connected. Can I tell y'all what I've discovered? And y'all ain't got to shout. Believers don't need to just be saved. Believers need to be fixed. Okay. Is there anybody other than me in here this morning or even at home? Anybody other than me have the honest testimony? I know I'm saved. I know I love the Lord. And I know I'm filled with the precious Holy Ghost. But even though I'm saved, and even though I love the Lord, and even though I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, I need Jesus to keep working on me. Come on, I'm looking. I thought I was at the Wild Wild West. I'm looking for the real folks. Say, I'm saved and I love the Lord. But if the Lord don't keep working on me, there's some stuff I'ma keep doing. There's some ways I'ma keep acting. There's some words I'ma keep saying. There's some liquor I'ma keep drinking. There's some weed out. Y'all done got quiet on me. I need the Lord to work on me. I need some stuff fixed and some stuff changed. You ought to just throw your head back and just yell, work on me, Lord. Work on me. Jesus wants to fix the sister so that she no longer needs hookups to look up. Because her problem wasn't men, her problem was the brokenness of her own value. See, one of the problems with the church is we try to preach the badness out of people without addressing the brokenness that made the badness. Y'all don't like this today. So we want to beat them over the head with the Bible. Stop being this and stop doing that and stop having sex and stop being a drunk and stop being a gossip. But we don't address the brokenness that caused the badness. Maybe they're that way because they got molested. Maybe she's that way because she was abused. Maybe he's that way because of what he said. See, I quiet y'all off. And if the church would begin to address the brokenness, people would address their own badness. Some stuff got to be fixed before other things get changed. Some issues of badness flow out of other issues of brokenness. And until we get healed, we can't get right. I don't know who I'm talking to. I don't know who I'm talking to, but it's time for you to heal. So that you speak from your wounds and not from your scars. We're working here, Holy Ghost. It's time for you to heal. So that you stop outsourcing your worth to other people. It's time for you to heal so you can stop being loyal to an unhappy version of yourself. Jesus. It's time for you to heal so that you can declare, I don't have to be who I used to be. I don't have to settle for that version of myself. And do I have any witnesses that knows Jesus will address every issue in your life, every brokenness in your life, and begin to heal you so that you can walk in purpose? All right, I'm done. I done got older now. I don't preach as long. I'm done. She didn't lose it. She left it. Because Jesus showed her that I'm going to use you even though I don't need you. But then Jesus showed her, I'm going to use you, but then I'm going to change you because I can't leave you like I found you. Here's the last thing. Your transformation will be evidenced in the change of your conversation. We'll know you change not only by how you start talking, but what you start talking about and what you stop talking about. Okay. All right. She leaves the water pot. Now, before this, she wouldn't talk about her issue, her man issue, what was not because of men, but it was the manifestation of her brokenness. She wouldn't talk about what she felt about herself. All she talked about was give me something to avoid what I'm dealing with. But when Jesus touched her in the broken pieces of her spirit, Jesus, look what she did. She ran back to the town and said, come see a man. Y'all ain't ready. Now what's deep is, Danielle, Jesus doesn't tell her to do that. Jesus. She does it because of what the talk did for her and in her. Because when Jesus has changed your life and when he has turned you around and when he has blessed you in ways you did not imagine he would, he ain't got to tell you to lift your hands. He ain't got to tell you to love your enemy. He doesn't have to tell you to be grateful. There's some stuff you just automatically do. If you know the Lord has changed your life, you don't need to preach to be a praise bully and stand up here and tell you, lift your hand, stand up on your feet. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all God's done for me, I stand up and ain't nobody else standing. I holler and ain't nobody else hollering, because I know what the Lord did. Baby, you know you've been changed by what you're willing to talk about. Watch it. Now, before, she couldn't even face the women, much less the men. But the original Koinonia text says she don't go back to everybody. No, that's when they sanitized translations. She went back to the men. Five ex-husbands. Others who didn't make the husband list. Y'all ain't talking. Others who slid in the DMs. Others she flirted with but didn't do nothing else with. Others she flirted with and maybe did something else with. Y'all ain't talking. She goes back to the men. I'm finna run, somebody, because sometimes the evidence of my transformation is in who I can face now. I know I've been changed when I know everything you did to me, how you dogged me, how you lied on me, how you stabbed me in the back, and I can come and sit my butt right next to you in church and high five you and smile at you and give God praise. I know I've been changed when I can go to work on a Monday, walk right by your desk where you tried to get me fired and speak to you and wish blessings on you. I know I've been changed when you dogged me in the divorce and I still wish blessings on your new marriage. How many of y'all can think back over your life and say, Lord, I know you changed me, because there's some folk I can face I used to cuss out. There's some folk I can hug I want to slap the hell out of. There's some people I pray for when I wanted to dog them. I know I've been changed. Come on, high five your neighbor in the air. Don't touch them. CDC regulation. And tell them, I know I've been changed, because there are some people I can face that I never would have faced. My talk has changed. I talk like I've been delivered. I talk like I've been set free. I talk like the Lord started me over. I want to find my delivered folk in here today who don't need me to tell you nothing to do. I don't need to tell you to lift your hand. I don't need to tell you to shout for joy. But you're going to start thinking, yes, about the goodness of Jesus and how he turned your life around. I ain't going to have to tell you to stand on your feet. I ain't gonna have to tell you to open up your mouth. I'm not gonna have to tell you to lift up your hand, because when you start to think about how far the Lord brought you, and when you start to think about all the Lord's done for you, you can run and tell people, come see a man who told me all about myself. Come see a man who turned my life around. Come see a man who changed the value of my life. Come see a man who fixed my situation. And I'm looking for a few people this morning who ain't ashamed today to say, I left some stuff, but I didn't leave empty-handed. I left a water pot, but I picked up value. I left depression, but I picked up joy. I left meanness, but I picked up love. And I'm looking for the Friendship Whisper who can say, I left my water pot, but the Lord replaced it with something even better. Good morning, Friendship West. May the Lord God bless you real good. But is there anybody in here who can help me close this sermon? If you know the Lord has changed your life, if you know the Lord has turned you around, if you know the Lord has given you new joy, new peace, new understanding, new love, won't the Lord give you a new start? Won't the Lord give give you new joy. Won't the Lord renew your strength? Won't the Lord renew your joy? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he fight your battles? Won't he make your enemies your footstool? Won't he give you joy and sorrow? Won't he give you hope for tomorrow? Won't he dry your tears? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he? Because I know the Lord changed me. Somebody about the goodness of the Lord, because like the old folks said, what a wonderful change in my life has been since Jesus came into my heart. That one didn't get you. Then I can go back further with the old saints who said, Lord, I know I've been changed. In heaven, done sign my name. Is there anybody in Friendship West who knows the Lord changed your life? The Lord picked you up, turned you around, gave you a new start, put the water pot down, pick up your joy, put the water pot down, pick up your life, put the water pot down. Salvation, put the water pot down, pick up your smile, because one Friday on a hill called Calvary, they hung him high, they stretched him wide, he hung his head in the locks of his shoulder, he died all night Friday, he died all day Saturday. He got up, I can get up. Because he got up, I can lift up. Because he got up, I can look up. Because he got up, I can walk on. So today, put it down. Done with depression, done with anxiety, done with insecurity, done with suicidal thoughts. If you're done, say yeah, yeah, yeah. Somebody say, what you doing? Putting it down. Somebody say, what's wrong with y'all? Putting it down. Because the Lord.
What are you carrying that you won't leave, that's keeping you from your best self? What water pot did you pick up to bring to church with you, that's keeping you from smiling?
keeping you from rejoicing, keeping you from knowing your value. What are you carrying that won't let you heal from your brokenness? And everybody wants to judge you on your badness, but nobody wants to minister to your brokenness. That's my problem with this church, this modern day church. We think we can shout everybody out of badness. Hell, I can't even preach my way out of badness. If the church does not get off, in the words of my late mentor, Dr. Charles Edward Booth, the high horse of our pomposity, if we don't get off our high horse of thinking we got it all together and start ministering to the broken places in people. I don't care what none of these preachers say. Everybody's badness is not a willful choice. Some people are making choices because they haven't been taught about the brokenness that has overcome their ability to make right choices. You got people in this room and you got people at home who are broken. And we roll our eyes at them, suck our teeth at them, don't want them to sit next to us. Which is really more evidence of your brokenness. That water pot of judgment is really a water pot of insecurity, because the only way you can like you is when you can talk bad about somebody else. But Jesus has come. Jesus, have mercy. To heal your brokenness. This morning, I want you to leave that water pot right there in the pew. That thing you haven't gotten past. That person, that hurt. Yes. Freddie, I've heard this preached all my life. And when I was a younger preacher, interested in more sensationalism, I did. I preached that this woman was loose and she was a hoe and she just misogynistic, just beating her up. No, she's none of that. She's none of that. None of it. She's broken. And the manifestation of her brokenness was in choices. See, hers was men. What's yours? This ain't got nothing to do with sex. What's yours? I want to pray. I don't want to pray this morning for the broken areas of lives, Jesus. That your brokenness get healed. Because I'm a living witness. I'm 56. I'll be 57 this year. I started therapy last year. I have a therapist I meet with every week. Every week. And I ain't mentally challenged. I mean, I got some issues. Don't get it twisted. But I got some areas of badness that I needed to connect to something in brokenness to help me heal the area of my badness. And all these Christian preachers, talking about therapy mean you don't have faith. The devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. That's why the church is so toxic and crazy and dysfunctional and full of hell. Because we're not ministering to people's brokenness. Come on, let's pray. So God, this morning, I wrestled last night and even this morning, and you spoke to me this morning in my prayer time to preach this word today, because the church is so broken. We're so broken. We're toxic and we're judgmental. We're dysfunctional. We're power hungry. All water pots. God, thank you for reminding us today that at the end of the day, the only person that matters when it comes to value is you and me. When I know who you say I am, it doesn't matter who others say I am. When I know who you say I am, I can get right about who I say I am. And God, there are people in here today who deal with brokenness. They've been broken by other people, broken by issues in their family, broken by actions taken upon them by family members and close friends. They've been broken. God, today, help them know that you can heal the area of their brokenness. You can minister to them in the area that has been broken so long that broken has become normal for them. They're scared to be healed because they're scared to be happy because they don't know what happy looks like. But God, I declare today, you've got the power to help us put some stuff down. Heal us of our brokenness so that we can run back and tell other people, I found somebody. I found somebody who told me all about myself. I went to therapy at a water well, and the therapist told me all about myself. Thank you that you're a mighty good therapist, because you said, come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Thank you. Through somebody's tears in here this morning. Somebody wants to scream, but they're scared to, because they don't want folk to know the pain and the water pot they've been carrying all this time. So they're just crying uncontrollably. They're sobbing. Tears are racing down their cheek, and God, let them know that's okay. Heal us so we can put stuff down and pick up value and assignment. Now, God, if there's anybody this morning, online or in person, who does not know your son as their savior, if they don't know that this Jesus has the ability to heal the first brokenness in their life, and that is sin, the brokenness of relationship with you, help them to realize today that confessing your son as savior will be the first step in the healing of brokenness. Because it is through Jesus where the brokenness of relationship with you begins to be mended. Or God, if there's somebody listening today, and or they're in this sanctuary today and they don't have a church, they've come out of the pandemic, no longer connected, no longer covered, no longer being cultivated, then God, today, help them know that this church is a church that can minister to them, cover them, and then put them on the right track. Help them be bold enough today to put down the water pot of fear and pick up boldness to make a choice. In Jesus' name. If you believe it and you thank God for it, I want you to yell one time like you know you've been changed. Come on, just open up your mouth behind that mask and holler. Yeah, 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 come on. If you know the Lord has changed you, come on, everybody stand on your feet. So now I know we changed our method after the pandemic. People still come down, or they still come down. Cool in the gang, in the words of Freddie Haynes. You in this sanctuary, main floor or balcony. I don't know who you are. Don't wait till tomorrow night. I'm going to be back tomorrow night. I'm going to go home and pray about it. What is there to pray about? Don't play with prayer that way. Don't play with time that way. God has given you a chance today. Put that water pot down. Bishop, I want Jesus Christ as my Savior. Bishop, I'm saved, but I got out there doing my thing, doing like I want to do, living like I want to live. Pandemic, man, I just got messed up. But today I want to reconnect. Today I want a church. I want you to do quick. You ain't got to wait. Put that water pot down right now and come walking my way right now. Bishop, I don't have it all figured out, but I know I need Jesus. And God knows I need a church. I don't care where you are in this sanctuary right now. Come on, no fear. In that balcony, walk down. On this main floor, walk out right now. No fear. I'm making a choice today. I'm not waiting till tomorrow, because tomorrow is not promised to me. If the Lord has given me today, hey, you move first. Watch what the Lord's going to do. Come on, come on. Yeah, I see you walking. Come on, right now, right now, right now, right now. It doesn't matter who's looking at you right now. Make up yourself no reputation. This is not about anybody in this sanctuary but you. This is not about what anybody thinks but you. This is not about anybody's opinion but the Lord's. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Put that water pot down and make your way. Put that water pot down and make your way. Come on this morning. Just tell them, walk with me, walk with me. Come on. I see you coming over here. I see you coming over here. Yes. Come on this morning. Come on. A harvest is waiting. A harvest is waiting. Come on. Woo! I love it. I love it. I love it. Come on this morning. Come on. Come on. Woo! Still got time. The Lord is still waiting on you. Come on. Come on. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, yes. Come on. Come on. Your water pot carrying days are over. Your water pot carrying days. Bless you, baby. Woo. Oh, mama. Come on, your water pot carrying days are over. Hallelujah. Woo. Oh, mama. Hey. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Come on, I'm going to wait just a few more minutes, because I feel like there are a couple more of you. This your first time back in a church. You said, I'm coming to church today because I'm coming to see Rudy. That was the wrong choice. I didn't die for you, and I ain't gonna die for you. Come see a man who can tell you all about your church. This your first time back in the church. You haven't been in the church in 3 years. Don't you come in here today just to get a good word. Come in here and get your life reconnected today. Get a reboot. Get a restart. I see you right here. Get re-energized. Yes, yes, yes. Oh, my. Hallelujah. Oh, my. Woo. I see you walking down the side. I see you coming down over here. Hey, y'all not clapping good enough. I need y'all. I know you got a mask on. That means you got to clap harder. Yes. Bless your daughters. Bless you. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm done. I'm done. I'll see y'all tomorrow night. It's going to be lit. You can still come while I'm talking. I'm done. Pray tomorrow night for Pastor Jackie coming from the West Coast. Yeah, I can't wait to hear her tomorrow night. Yeah, yeah. And then pray for your boy that the Lord will renew my strength to preach one more time tomorrow. Hey, if you putting your water pot down, and if you excited about those that have come, even behind that mask, can you holler and give God a good praise?
God, that God can make sure you put that water pot down. Let's thank God for our new family members. Welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the gift of new life in Christ Jesus. Thank you so much for salvation. Thank you for church family and fellowship and the power of a loving fellowship. Thank you for this word, and thank you for water pots that have been put down. Thank you that you, oh God, are still in the liberating business, freeing us, healing us. And now I pray your blessings upon these, your children, who you, oh God, have ordered to make the choice to connect with Jesus and this, your church. God bless them. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. Order their lives in your word. And bless them in such a way that all will know they put their water pots down. And they, oh God, have connected with you. And they are telling everybody, come see a man. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please go with our decision counselors, our ministers. They're going to minister to you in a private area and officially welcome you to Friendship West. Come on, Friendship West. Let's thank God for our new family. Thank God for our new family members. Amen. Well, y'all, revival has started, huh? Did not our hearts burn within? That's what the old preacher would say. Did not our hearts burn within? What a preacher. What a word. What a gift Bishop Rudolph McKissick is. Praise God with me for Bishop Rudolph McKissick, for the word that blessed us in such a powerful way. Please be seated right quick, and we're going to get things moving toward the close of our worship experience. First of all, please don't forget, as Bishop has said, this is just the beginning. Tomorrow night, we continue. The Reverend Dr. Jackie Thompson, who has been with us for a few years now, she will be with us tomorrow night. I think you know how we roll. 7 o'clock we start, and by 7:20, 7:25, Dr. Thompson's going to be up preaching. And then Bishop McKissick will follow after Dr. Thompson. So don't miss any night, because it's going to be a powerful, powerful week. Also, Tuesday night, the Reverend Reginald Wayne Sharp. He's my classmate, cohort mate. If you heard him last year, you know what he's going to do. And he just finished preaching at Hampton for the Ministers Conference. And when I tell you, oh my God, so please get yourself ready for what's going to happen. And then you know what happens Wednesday night with Dr. Marcus D. Cosby. Now, Bishop McKissick is going to follow them every night. So it's just going to be an amazing, crazy, powerful week. And I'm super excited about what God is going to do. So let's come praying, okay? Matter of fact, every day at noon, would you just stop for a moment and pray? Pray for the revival. Pray for the preachers. Pray for God to move in a powerful way in your life. Can we do that every day at noon? Every day at noon, just stop where you are, whisper that prayer, and wherever you are in the world, when it hits noon, go ahead, stop, whisper that prayer, and watch God show up as only God can do. All right, now, I think that is, oh, I got to do this right quick. I want to acknowledge right quick, because it's a special day, and where is Dr. Monica Williams? Where are you, Dr. Monica Williams? Dr. Monica Williams, are you in the house? There you are, Dr. Monica Williams. She's celebrating her birthday. She is president of the UNT Dallas Foundation. We're so proud of you and your work, and we thank you that you have come to share with us today, you and family and friends, because this is your birthday. It's your birthday. Thanks for all that you are doing for Deb and for your support of her work and her ministry. So happy birthday, and thank you so much for being with us. All right, God bless you, God keep you. I think the only thing I have to say is it's offering time. It's offering time, time to give. I want to give you all this. This blessed me this week. I was helping Albany move, and so did all I could to help her move and trying to, you know, ensure she gets off to a good start as she, you know, makes this move. And so I gave her a lot, was trying to be generous and help her and all that stuff. And then this happened. This cracked me up. This happened. So we go out to eat. And while we are out to eat, you know, I'm paying for everything. And so I get shocked, Pastor Ayers, because she pulls out this gift card and says Visa and all this stuff. And next thing I know, they bring the check. And she gives them the gift card to pay for the meal. And what was funny is that it was a gift card I had given her. And I fell out laughing because she's going to treat me. With what I gave her. And it just cracked me up. And then the Lord said, "Now, why are you laughing? That's exactly what I do for you when I give to you. And come Sunday morning, it's your time to pull out the gift card." Now, I know what Creflo Dollar has, you know, Creflo Dollar has tripped everybody out. And I just want to read a text to you. So that this is what the Bible says. I'm going to just give you what Jesus said. Jesus says in Matthew 23:23, okay? He goes off on the Pharisees. He says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law, Pharisees, you hypocrites. You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin." He says, "You give a tenth of the smallest of stuff, but you've neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter." You should have tithed. That's what Jesus said. You should have done that without neglecting the former. So whatever I'm glad he's, whatever he's going through, but I'm just going to stick with Jesus for now. And because he's brought me this far, so I'm not going to give up on him. And that's what he says, okay? So Albany paid for her father's meal with what her father had given her. That is really what tithing is. Tithing is saying, "God, you've already given this to me. Now I want to give it back to you." So I'm asking you right now to prepare your heart. If you're watching online, we got those ways to give. You can scan the QR code, text to give, text FWBC to 972-200-9419. Of course, there's a Givelify app, as long as you search out Friendship West. And you can give online through our church app and through our website, friendshipwest.org. And if you're in the house and you're old school, you can give, of course. We've got an envelope. And you can give the envelope, fill the envelope up, and then give on your way out as we worship God in giving. Now let's thank God for the privilege of giving. God, thank you so much for giving to us. And now we want to treat you. We want to do our part so your kingdom can come on earth as it is in heaven. So please bless each giver, bless the gift, and then use gift and giver in a very powerful way to make a difference in this world. We thank you now for what we've experienced this day, and we, in the name of Jesus, give back to you, saying thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me say thank you to the choir. Let me tell you something. Y'all did that thing. And I'm glad your schedule is free on Sundays, okay? Thank you so much. That's for her Facebook post. But where are the youth praise dancers? There they are right there. My youth praise dancers, y'all are something special. That was it, okay? That was it. Y'all are the best. Thank you very much for blessing us in such a powerful way. To all who are praying, we thank God for you. And now we're going to give the benediction, and we look forward to what God is going to do all week long. God bless you. God keep you. Don't you praise God for the wonderful harvest we had today? That was hot. All right. Please receive God's benediction. Have a wonderful day, blessed and powerful week. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause God's face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you, give you peace. Go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit. Take the water pot off your head, drop it, leave it, and experience God's possibility. In Jesus' name, peace.
We praise God for this impactful experience and for your joining us during it. Check us out on social media and please like, share, and subscribe at Friendship West. Then go to www.friendshipwest.org to find out more about this marvelous movement. Find out how to participate through sharing your prayers, sharing your offerings or monetary gifts, or sharing and investing your time volunteering with this difference-making ministry. For you who are viewing as visitors, you can share that you were here by taking time to text FWVIZ to the number 28950. For those who want this time that you are visiting to be the last time that you're a visitor, you can become part of our fabulous family of faith, either by calling 469-498-0210 or by emailing joinus@friendshipwest.org with your first name, your last name, and your cell number. Either way, we look forward to hearing from you. We're so excited that you are here.